Because you know I'm all about justice, bad justice, no Joker. I'm all about justice, bad justice, no Two-Face. I'm all about justice, bad justice, no Penguin. I'm all about justice, bad justice. Yeah, it's pretty clear, I ain't no bad dude, but I can punch it, make all the villains poof. Cause I give them boom boom back fist in their face, and all the right punch in all the right places. I see the Catwoman robbing a jewelry shop. We know that shit is bad, I will not make her stop. But she got beauty, and then I'll stop. So I think I might leave this one to be dealt with by the cops. Yeah, my mama, she got guns at one night in time.
She got pop.
And then I became Batman to take down the star, my sweet.
Batman.
I'm fall victim to the toxin from the scarecrow.
Won't drop, he won't drop.
So if that's what you plan for, it's off to Arkham you go. Because you know I'm all about justice, bad justice, no Riddler. I'm all about justice, bad justice, no Harley. I'm all about justice, bad justice, no Ivy. I'm all about justice, bad justice. Hey, Falcone's selling crack. I'll get the dealers off the corners fast. No, I'm not playing, I know you think you're that. But I'm here to tell you, every inch of Gotham is mine, so I'll knock you on your ass. Yeah, my mama, she got guns and one night in crime alley. And then I became Batman to take down the scum I see.
Good Batman.
I know that thing broke my back, but I hid and escaped his feet. And I know that he has fans, but Nolan's vein is my cheat. Because you know I'm all about justice, not justice, no Joker. I'm all about justice, not justice, no Two-Face. I'm all about justice, not justice, no Penguin. I'm all about justice, not justice. Because you know I'm all about justice, not justice, no Riddler. I'm all about justice, not justice, no Harley. I'm all about justice, not justice, no Ivy. I'm all about justice, not justice. Because you know I'm all about justice, not justice, no Joker. I'm all about justice, not justice, no Two-Face. I'm all about justice, not justice, no Penguin. I'm all about justice, not justice, not justice, not justice. Hey. Ooh, you know you like justice. Hey. I'm not mad.
Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, whatever time of day you've taken to join us, and however you've chosen to tune in tonight, or, indeed, whatever time of day, as I aforementioned, that you've chosen to tune in, we thank you here from the Batcave. I'm your host, Red Thunder, Adam Gerard, and I'm joined into this inquest, this trial, this jury into all things DC, and once again, Marvel, by my comrades and partners and, well, amigos, compatriots in
senior
crime.
Partners.
I have no senior partners. Which brings me to my senior partner, the Dad Knight, Brendan Hearn.
Hello.
And of course we have the junior associate, Honey Vegetarian Neil.
That's me.
And of course we have the shit-kicking janitor that none of us want to talk to because he's probably a fucking serial killer with a body hidden downstairs, the bravey Matt Richens.
G'day.
And how are we all this week, gentlemen?
I'm knackered. I've been working my ass to the fucking bone tonight.
Oh, I thought you meant you're actually knackered, kind of like what we did to the gimp. I thought the surgery was taking place.
Speaking of knackered, and we'll get into it later on, you'll notice that Lou Ferrigno actually nut grabs of the guy, the guards in the trial and
against
the wall. But like when you like when I was watching it with Terry, you could actually see his jeans tighten around his buttocks, which means that
Lou Ferrigno
got full grip and possibly clenching. But anyway, I'm good.
Better than that guy, that's for sure.
A lot better than that guy.
So you're not at Lou Ferrigno grabbing your balls sort of pain at the moment?
Oh, shit, no. Right.
That's a new level of pain. It is.
Yeah, I don't have much else to say to that. Like, what? There isn't much else. Braden, what do you got to say? What do you think about Lou Ferrigno grabbing your nuts? Would you be down?
Oh, definitely be down for that. Well, I like it rough.
All right. Well, it's been an interesting week this week. We've had the aftermath of the Batman trailer and the first week of the first weekend, I should say, is the release of the Avengers Age of Ultron. I know a half of this this team has seen it. The senior associate partners have seen it, and then
good
juniors.
To see you've gotten out of math today. That's
the juniors. Look, man. Knowledge is a tricky thing.
Man.
Yeah, look, I'm John Diggle. I don't need math. I just need my amazing skills in life and my ability to drink whiskey as straight as possible.
Yeah.
And my ability to say man at the end of every sentence, man.
Fair enough, man.
Man.
Fair call, man.
All right, well, let's look at starting this show with a bang by getting into this week on TV.
My name is Oliver Queen. After 5 years in hell, I have come home with only one goal, to save my city. To the rest of Starling City, I am someone else. I am something else.
My name is Barry Allen, and I am the fastest man alive. A friend recently gave me the idea for a new name, and something tells me it's gonna catch on.
James Gordon, Alfred Pennyworth. I'm gonna get the guy that did this, sir.
New boy, are ya?
That's right.
Good luck, mate.
Disappointment. And why is it disappointment? Because we start off this week with Pravy's review of Gotham. Which, I say disappointment, it's only disappointment because we have to listen to him do the review, but I find that myself, it's my favourite part of the week. I look forward to this every week because we get to review the ever-growing skill set of the Pravy. So Pravy, take it away.
Alright, Gotham episode 20, Under the Knife. The ogre calls Gordon and threatens to kill someone he loves if Gordon does not stop the investigation. Gordon and Bullock investigate the first victim of the killer. Following the incident with Reggie, Bruce and Selina attend Wayne Enterprises' charity ball with Barbara Keene, where Selina steals keys from Sid Brandeslaw? Is that how you say his name?
Brandeslaw.
Brandeslaw. There you go. Yeah, probably fucked it up again. Anyway.
That's right, we're used to that.
Aren't we all? One of our directors who sent in Reginald Payne to Wayne Manor. Cobblepot allies himself with the Irish mob boss O'Connor with hopes of killing Maroney, but Sal plays a visit to the club where he reveals to Oswald's mother that her son is a killer. Oswald swears to Maroney that he will pay. Nigma tries to protect Kristen Kringle from her boyfriend Tom Doherty, but goes too far when he stabs him a dozen times and has a psychotic breakdown saying, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. Gordon, Bullock and Essen identify the killer as Jason stupid fucking name. Skolimowski, that's the one. Stupid name. Anyway, I suck at English, alright?
No, you had it right, you suck.
The son of the Constance Van Groot.
Constance.
Can't stand ya!
It says Constance. C-O-N.
Yeah, her name's Constance. You said Constance.
Oh, well, he's a cunt.
Actually, yeah, keep going.
Just because he was on fucking The Nanny doesn't make him a fucking
That's
god.
True. Yep. That's a good point.
Anyway, the butler, Jacob Skolimowski, who went under the Van Groot last name, only to be rejected by his adoptive mother, Constance. Mm-hmm. Because of this, he changed his face and identified in a local hospital where he found his first victim. To his horror, Gordon realizes that the ogre knew about him from the charity gallery which Gordon had visited a long time ago with Barbara, meaning that she is the target. Upon learning from Selena and Barbara that Barbara is not there, Gordon works to find her at his apartment, and the ogre shows Barbara his BDSM lair, aka 50 Shades of Grey.
Hmm. Our next essential crisis this week, just before I get into reviewing Proby's effort there, before we do the roundtable, and that was the fact that Barbara actually looked pretty good this week.
She didn't look good. She didn't look good. She looked fucking damn hot.
Like, and it gave, like, I didn't know what to do because I was like, man, my penis says one thing, but I want it, like, I want him to kill you at the same time.
So your mind is telling you no, but your body is telling you yes?
I'm pretty sure that's a precursor for a...
My body is telling me...
I'm pretty sure that's a precursor for a rapist.
No, 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 I'm not a rapist, it's pronounced therapist, not the rapist, therapist.
Sorry, Sean Connery.
You pronounce things wrong.
The rapist for $50.
Celebrity titties. Famous titties for $1,000.
Anal bum for $5.
Buck butter. I don't even know what buck butter means, I bet you don't, Trebek.
We meet again, Trebek.
Anyway, enough of that tangent. Let's get into reviewing Proby before we review Gotham. What do you think, guys? How do you do?
He's got to work on his English skills a bit more.
Yeah, dust off the Saurus.
The Saurus and the dictionary.
Yeah, that's where he's got wrong. See, the Saurus, not the rapist.
Oh, my bad.
Therapist.
No worries, he's getting better. It's his second review.
Yeah, C+.
Yeah. C.
You know, I'm still holding average, so that's not bad.
All right, well, that wraps up our review of Proby. Mm-hmm. Oh, well, that's our review of his review of Gotham. We're going to review him all night on, like, his stench and his face and everything else associated with him. But in the meantime, let's talk Gotham. Brayden, what did you think?
Improvement from last week. I do have a bit of a problem, though, when your side stories are better than your main story, it's not. Like, you've got... I'm glad we didn't see Fish this week. God, thank God we didn't see Fish this week. Mm-hmm. The structure of the show was really good. You know, you had two side stories. You had Penguin, you had Riddle Man.
Riddle Man.
and then obviously Gordon... following up from last week and probably going to follow on until the rest of the season, end of the season, I would imagine, with Yoga.
Mm-hmm.
There's going to be a bit of story behind it, bringing Barb back. the side stories, I'll start with Riddler. That was great. Yep.
Yeah.
Awesome.
He's fucking time. Yeah, it was, yeah. Yeah, like that snapping point was just... it was perfection. He did it perfectly.
Yeah.
I love how that the first one was, like, the first stab was unintentional, but he just sort of kept going.
Yeah,
and he just went
like,
with it.
This is wrong, but, oh, my God, I like it. Sort of. I think the fact that he liked
what happens when you get blood
him.
I just like how they had the, almost like a pre-warning that it was going to happen when he was stabbing the watermelons.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't think about that until, like, you know, when I was watching it and like he just kept stabbing him, I was just thinking like that's straight back to the watermelon part of the episode.
Yeah, absolutely.
Good point.
Yep. You're onto something there, Proby. Well done.
He's fractured the code.
No.
Give him a fracture.
He's chipped away a little bit of the glass, but he's
the enamel. Just the enamel.
Yeah.
Yeah. He's chipped the enamel.
He's dented the code.
He's dented
slightly. Scuffed.
Pitted.
No, Pitcher would be worse than scuffed.
Like,
I'm trying to help you out here, man.
Because you know, I don't think there's any actual doubt. Like, he could buff it out, is what I'm trying to say. Probably with like.
Yeah, so he sneezed on it.
Yeah.
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 He's ejaculator on the code.
Oi.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So you have a fit with the serial killer, because that's really the only thing missing from what happened with Nigma to make it like a good old-fashioned proper serial killer was just a bit of semen. That's what CSI is talking about.
You know,
that's what I've learned. I'm surprised. I haven't had that class yet, but I imagine there is a class I'm going to soon that's simply collecting semen and the places you will find it, and they'll be like, under the fridge. Or like, you know, yeah. Or I'll be like, hey, I found some more semen. Oh, where's this one? Bathroom! I got some more! Kitchen sink! Oh, wait a minute, what's this? Why is it in the towel rack? What is... Yeah, there it is.
Oh my god, there's someone in the ear. I guess you heard the killer coming. That suits.
Preby soundboard is paying off this week.
That investment of $0.
Yeah, I don't know what to say about this episode apart from... Yeah, I liked the Riddler.
Mm.
I really liked that. Didn't like much else, and I mentioned this on a post on our Facebook wall earlier this week, which, if you don't go there, feel free to head on over to From the Batcave on Facebook and comment on our post, give us a like, and
give
just
some
enjoy
feedback.
The general merriment.
Yeah, we want feedback.
Yeah, join the community.
Mm.
But I commented on there that I'm actually really looking forward to this show going on hiatus, because I'm hoping that absence will make the heart grow fonder and I'll miss it, because it's a chore to watch at the moment.
Yeah.
Mm. Mm.
Myself and Probe I did watch it, and I watched it the second time with Probes, and we had a discussion about the final scene, and we wondered how Barbara is going to either get herself out of that situation, or does she join the ogre, but then Matt turned around and said, she fucks up his face.
Yeah.
That's how she gets away, and he reclaims that title of the ogre. So
maybe.
She gets out of there by fucking up his face.
Now, when you say Matt thought of that, Braden, didn't you mention to me earlier this week that you'd had the exact same thought?
Yeah. Yep.
So he's once again stolen.
No. This is... We had no connect talk to Braden or anything like that. This is...
I refuse to believe that.
Thank you, Terry, and...
I got you back on that one.
Where is it? No, that's not it. I fucked it up.
Yeah. What a shock. He fucked it up again.
It's over.
You're the best.
Damn, motherfucker.
What are you doing?
Yeah.
What are you doing to me, Proby? Yeah. Are you having like some sort of a fucking breakdown or something?
It's an MS fit.
MS, yeah.
Hey, that's my word. You're not one of my people.
Goddamn ginger.
Don't call another ginger.
This is... You all cannot use our words. Now, yeah, I'm just looking forward to this show.
Going on a hiatus. I am looking forward to seeing Barbara get her rack out. Because that'll happen.
Good luck. On this show?
You won't.
I'm allowed to hope.
On a PG-rated American TV show.
At least show me her lower back.
I'm pretty sure that's what...
Oh, shucky-ducky.
I'm pretty sure that's what fake celebrities is for.
Yeah, it's pretty much. That's pretty much.
Yeah, but... Fake's not the real thing. Like, that's like saying, like, well, I could get a fleshlight instead of a girlfriend.
You know what? At the end of the day, it's cheaper.
Or conversely, I could get a tube sock instead of a girlfriend.
It's cheaper and less of a headache.
Yeah,
you're still right.
Better to wash myself than either.
That's true.
Anyway.
Well, yeah, anybody got any other thoughts on Gotham? Because once again, filler episode, last 5 minutes mattered.
It's a show of ham, basically. That's how I'd just, like, have we seen Gotham yet? That's not Gotham. I just call it Gotham, because it's just crap. It's just filler crap. I'm just tired of it.
And I don't know, they don't even know where they're going.
Nah, it's one of those shows where they're hoping people are going to stick around just to see where the big story's going. We know where it's going, but how they get there.
Will he become Batman?
Maybe.
Jim Gordon becomes Batman, yeah?
Yeah. Selina Kyle is Batman.
I thought it was Alfred Pennyworth.
Pennyworth?
Yeah, I thought he became Batman. After he killed Bruce.
No, he just leaves to Florence.
I just want to see you happy. Master Bruce. I just wanted to say that I want to see Master Bruce happy and you complain about me cutting you off. If I wanted to see somebody cut off, I'd sit in bloody Paris and wait.
Fuck you, Thunder. You can suck my dick. You can't get me, Thunder, because you're just God's fart.
How mature.
I will strike at you any way I can, sir.
What was so important that you had to have your little fucking hissy fit?
No, I was just going to say I enjoyed that episode.
Oh, is that all you're going to say? Then fine, let's move on to something else.
Okay. Fuck you.
No, go ahead, come on.
No,
come on.
I enjoyed it. I thought I was sort of skeptical about watching it. I partially put it off as late as I could because real life came first, but I had to watch it because I have to review it on this show.
Breaking kayfabe, he's talking about real life.
Yeah, you broke kayfabe.
Fuck. Sorry, friends. Sorry. Anyway.
This is real to some people, Gamut. It's still real.
Yeah.
Oh, this is real to me, too.
No, it isn't.
No, it isn't. You said real life was more important.
Damn it.
You goddamn scroat.
I
like that.
Goddamn scroat.
Scroat. Scroat. Yeah, I like that.
Is it on the board yet?
No, I think we'll put scroat on the board.
We'll put it on the board. We'll put it on the board.
I actually enjoyed the episode. I was sort of starting watching it, sort of expecting it to be crap. But then, I don't know, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it.
Yeah?
I mean, comparatively to the previous episodes, yeah, it was a decent episode.
It wasn't a shit episode of, like, cutscene to fish down in the fucking catacombs.
Yeah, it's better when there's no fish. Better when there's no fish.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And like, there was only, what, two storylines in this? Maybe three?
Yeah, there was...
Penguin,
Riddler, Gordon.
Oh, yeah.
Four, sorry. Because there was also Bruce Wayne and Selina Kyle.
Oh, yeah. Four, yeah.
So
I had the four pivotal ones, I suppose.
Yeah.
Oh, no, I don't know if you call Riddler a pivotal one, but it's one that you actually want to see.
He's he's in the top four Batman villains. So.
Every
time you watch Gotham, though, like when there's the part with Ed in it, you actually watch that part, whereas the rest of it you skip over.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
So, like, that's almost been, like, the running thing holding it together.
I also like the fact that, they played out one thing correctly, which was we all were like, something to do with Kringle is going to make him
snap.
Yeah. And it was. Yeah. It was cop as well. It was the perfect, like, yeah.
Yep.
And now he's going to cover it up or something.
Yeah, you know.
And ultimately he's going to be like, you're all idiots.
Yeah, that's the thing. He's going to have that moment of, that Mayor moment.
I beat them,
yeah.
The what moment?
The Mayor moment?
Mayor!
Where he's more intelligent than, you know, the police force. And he can get away with stuff like this. Yeah. He may not commit murder and murder time and time again, but it may be a theft. It may be something to start funding his own organization. So, but that's...
Showing information.
Yeah. And you're absolutely right. It is that storyline that's sort of held its audience because that's the love story you never really expected to see. I certainly never expected to see it. So it's just one of those things that I wanted to see blossom more. Penguin I could care less about.
Yeah.
Even though, he's a ballsy character and Robert Lord Taylor does a fantastic job with him. But
over it?
It's not that I'm over it. It's just... It's
he can't the same thing every week. Without,
yeah.
It suffers from Simpsons formula where at the end of every week everything just resets like nothing ever happened.
And then they go back and cry for a week.
Yeah.
Actually, no, this episode did take over 2 days, I think.
They don't have the cry problem on Gotham. They just literally have the reset button at the end of every episode where it's like, well, back to default.
Yep. Ah, Gordon. Interfering with the commissioner's
plans. I'm
going
to get that damn Commissioner Loeb.
Shakes fist.
Following week, I'm going to get that damn Commissioner Loeb.
I'm going to clean up the streets.
Do like that they are holding on the line of him not backing down and like absolutely publicly calling out.
That was cool.
That was cool.
But that is a very Jim Gordon thing to do, though.
It is.
Jim Gordon and Bruce Wayne are the only characters, and Alfred probably are the only ones written right, for the most part.
Bullock's pretty good.
Yeah, but even
the characters are fantastic and the story's just meh.
You're right.
That's fair.
Alright, well let's move on to Flash episode 19.
That's right, ladies and gentlemen, episode 19. We're getting closer and closer to the end of the season, which means we found out who is Harrison Wells. Barry and Eddie track a metahuman named Hannibal Bates who can shapeshift into anyone he touches. But he takes Eddie's shape and frames him for murder. Later, Hannibal knocks Barry unconscious and assumes his form. But Dr. Wells realizes the truth and prevents Hannibal from killing Caitlin and Iris. While transporting him to Central City Police, Hannibal uses his powers to escape. Caitlin develops a serum to suppress Hannibal's power, allowing Barry to defeat him and clear Eddie's name. Meanwhile, Joe and Cisco decide to investigate the car accident scene in Starling City where Wells' wife Tess Morgan died, though Caitlin is still unsure that they are correct and believes they are going to ruin Dr. Wells' reputation. With the help of Captain Quinton Lance, Cisco and Joe locate a buried corpse near the crash site. After a series of tests confirm the corpse is the real Harrison Wells, Barry, Caitlin, and Cisco locate the imposter's secret room at Star Labs. They find both the Reverse Flash's costume and the newspaper article from the future concerning the Flash vanishing during the crisis. Or one of three. And that was this week's Flash.
Yeah, it's a pretty good episode.
Big drop.
What the frack?
Big drop. I was just like watching that and going, whoa!
Yeah.
Did not expect that.
It's very cool.
Like, because we knew, like, the last couple of episodes, Barry's been, like, twinging and being like, you know what? Harrison Wells is a fuck up.
Yeah.
And we're going to catch him.
Yeah.
And then just, like, bang, we caught him.
Yeah.
And it's just like, whoa! Okay.
Yep. I love the interaction in Starling City as well with the two detectives with each other. Lance like that seems to make more sense to me because his hatred is just simply towards the Arrow, so I think he's a really good cop.
Yeah.
I like the fact when, you know, when Joe's like, look, I'm asking a cop to cop, do not say anything about this, you need to bury this, like...
Just for a little bit.
You know, I'm investigating another case, I need you to trust me. And he's like, yeah, well, you're a cop.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, he's not just like, you know, because he could theoretically be like, I have a real issue with trust now. This one guy in
blah,
my
blah,
city...
Blah, blah, blah. My vagina is bleeding. My
nipples
are hurt. My daughter.
And also, like, the fact that, like, Joe as well is like, you know, it's your daughter, why don't you just not be, like, a dick? Yeah, pretty much.
Basically,
yeah.
Stop being a dick.
I like the Cisco and Canary match-up.
Interaction. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I'm just waiting for Fangirls to start. I really am.
Oh, we've got enough to cover on Oliver on Arrow when it comes to Fangirls.
Yeah.
Their ovaries dropped like a sack of shit.
Yeah, my testicles rose. But this is Flash we're talking about.
Yeah.
So,
where everything's sunny.
This was a good episode. It was nice to find out the Harrison Wells stuff.
It was good.
But to me, I won't say it's a filler episode, but it was just it was a bridging episode.
Yeah, it's bridging.
It was the characters now knowing what we're knowing, which is fine. But ultimately,
Caitlin's going to be interesting though.
Yeah.
How she turns.
Yeah.
She's going to be such a wild card.
I just like the fact that Wells has this magic room with all this future tech in it, but doesn't either have one alarm system or two, like a pager.
Yeah. Or the fact that Barry's hand can actually open it as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's interesting. Maybe it's actually triggered by Speed Force. Because
I did think that.
Or tachyons.
Tachyons are time traveling, so Barry has. He has time traveling now.
So he's had his first Pokemon evolution.
But still, I mean, come on.
At the same, yeah, it's pretty slack. But at the same time, for us to see them find out the information that we know, I'm not offended by that.
Mm-hmm.
What I do want to see what happens with Kate now that. Because she was, like, the biggest doubter of the three.
Yeah, absolutely.
And then all of a sudden she's, like, evidence. But
yeah.
I still feel that she's...
I think she's got a
huge emotional attachment to...
Absolutely. Because she's helped Ronnie out so much and all that and blah, blah, blah. And
yeah.
Over his and feeling.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's why there should be no female superheroes. Anyway. But it's... It was very much a bridging episode, but it was a damn good bridging episode where everything came together very nicely, very fluidly. I have nothing really negative to say about it. And I love Cisco, how he's the biggest geek. he's so geeky. When Ray eventually goes to Star City with Felicity and we finally get the Star Labs that we need, shut up, Raiden, the Ray and Cisco relationship's going to be phenomenal.
See, I reckon
to watch.
Ray's going, Felicity's not now.
I don't know.
I reckon they're done with Ray. Felicity's are done. I'll get into that later. We'll get into that in
probably.
Arrow. So I have some shit to say about that.
But at the same time, I really want to see that the Ray-Cisco relationship go full geek. It would be like having Big Bang Theory on Flash. It'll go even geekier, which would be great.
They're in their suits fucking playing Xbox.
I'm going to be the one to throw this out there, but the Big Bang Theory kind of sucks.
You know, I was actually referring to the geek level of it.
Oh, that's okay then.
That's
talking about the humour, because I don't want Flash where it's you take out the laugh track and it's just dudes stiltedly talking to each other.
Yeah, basically. But, I mean, like, just the geek factor, that's all it was. Like,
that's
them
okay.
geeking out over, like, a new iPad thingy or whatever.
It's the new iPad thingy!
That's the next thing. Okay, the iPod.
The iPod
where you insert it into an orifice and then Apple can control your body completely.
It monitors your regulatory of your colon and...
Excellent. That's what I need in my life.
No, this was a really good Flash this week. You're all right. Oh, Terry's computer's booted up and made a nice noise there.
It's okay. The one edit for the
It wasn't me.
Yeah, no, Flash this week was really good, you're right. Yeah. Don't know what more there is to say about it, apart from I'm looking forward to where it goes next week, because now we're starting to get into the back end of the world's mystery actually coming to fruition of what comes next and where it's going to go. Mm. So,
yeah, they're playing out their act the last 4 or 5 episodes.
Yeah, yep. Absolutely. Mm. Absolutely. All right, well, that brings us on then to Arrow.
Mm.
So, let's throw it over to our man in the studios in Traralgon. Mo, or some shit. You near Mo, aren't you?
Yeah.
Mo.
No, near Mo.
Mo.
No, near Mo.
Mo. Mo. Mo. The dad, not Brayden Hearn.
Episode 20, The Fallen. So this one leads off instantly after the last one did. Where we have Thea laying on the floor of her apartment after being stabbed by Raz. Oliver finds her and gets her to the hospital where he's told that they cannot save her. Oliver meets with Maseo, who says she can be saved if Oliver becomes Ra's al Ghul. He accepts, much to the disapproval of his team, and they all go to Nanda Parbat, following Felicity ditching Gray because Barbara Gordon and borrowing his jet. Thea is put into the pit and revived, but it is not the same person. Felicity and Oliver get it on, and Felicity drugs him in an attempt to break him out. This fails, and the team leave without him.
Who was the rapist, Matt?
Drugging came after sex.
Yeah, that's true.
That's even worse.
In our flashbacks, Oliver, Maseo, and Tatsu follow where the Alpha and Omega are and witness the two getting mixed together. They hijack a truck to take it back, but it was a decoy. After interrogating the driver, they find the bioweapon, and while attempting to get it back, it is released.
Yep. Good stuff. Fantastic episode.
Yeah, I know what's going on with the C-dub. Their writers have actually pulled their fingers out of their butts.
I do have a problem, though. I'm going to kick it off hard and fast. I'm going to hit it off with something that's really been getting to me. Something that's really been making me upset. And, quite honestly, it's making my chest hurt. It really is. And that's because, at the end of the day...
Ah, my nipples, they hurt! They hurt when I twist them!
They do. And why they hurt is a woman by the name of Felicity Smoke, who... I'm going to jump ahead to the awards section a little bit here and give you a preview. I'm about to invent a new award named after Felicity that'll be coming up in the awards section, so stay tuned for that. But I'm tired of Felicity Smoke and this constant, doesn't know what she wants, knows what she wants. She's led Ray on, used his money, gone on trips with him, all this shit, and ultimately just is like, doesn't even break up with him, just is like, I need to borrow your plane, I want a little bit of a break or some shit. And goes up and immediately fucks another guy within, like, I don't know, half an hour. What a hoe. Like, no lie, that's hoe baggery that I have not seen in my life. That's hoe baggery that should be in Guinness. Beyond somebody else Barbara say Gordon. Something, because I'm too mad about this, but no, she's outclassed Barbara Gordon, Braden.
Mm.
Barbara Gordon is like, Barbara Gordon is now the virtuous one that I want to marry in comparison to this hoe baggery.
So in comparison, so it's, what was it, marry, murder, kill? You'd marry Thea.
Yeah. Wait, no, it's
I
kill, fuck, marry.
Oh, kill, fuck, marry, so I got around the wrong way. I'm just...
So yeah, I would marry Thea. Marry Thea.
Marry Thea, fuck Barbara, kill Felicity.
Yep.
Why not both?
Don't care, Thea. I'm marrying Thea. Yeah, that's my order. I'm marrying Thea, fucking Barbara, I'm killing Felicity.
Yeah, and Ho Bagger, I think that should be the name of the, some sort of... When we call shenanigans on things, I call hoe-baggery.
Quite possibly. As I say, when I get to the awards section, I actually have smink come up in there, which I said about...
a new term.
I was scared, yeah. As I said a little bit earlier at the start, we're not listening to me because you thought Pravy was speaking.
Right.
And I said that coming up in the awards section, I have a new award to hand.
Oh, right. I thought this was terminology to apologize. I give the court my apologies.
But Hope Agri, I'm sure, will go into the lexicon of this show's thesaurus.
Thesaurus and the dictionary.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It'll be on dictionary without question.
Yeah, I have jumped on your bandwagon.
Hang on, so you're no longer off the wagon now, you're on the
wagon? I'm now on this wagon.
Okay, cool.
I'm there, I'm just driving the cart while you're there with the soapbox and the megaphone.
I was going to say, the megaphone, hear ye,
ringing the bell.
Hear of the Hobaggery, yoeth, gather round and heareth of this Hobaggery. The extent of this debauchery is something you have never seen.
She's kind of, I know she's probably, they've written this to sort of represent that torn woman between two men and blah blah blah.
Look, if anybody here can understand that somebody doesn't want to wait till for their life to be over, they want to know right now what will it be. It's me. I understand that, Terry.
No, I get that, but you've never been a torn woman. You've probably been a torn man, but never been a torn woman.
I wouldn't call him a man.
I've torn some women.
No, no, you haven't.
I have. So I know that because I left. I walked out the door and I shut it, and immediately Natalie and Brulia came on in the background.
With someone doing interpretive dance in the background.
Because nothing was right. They were torn. They're all out of hope.
But yeah.
This is how they feel. They're cold and they're alone, lying naked on the shore. Illusion never fade into something real. I'm wide awake and I can see the perfect sky is torn. You're a little late. I'm already torn.
See, I get fucking jumped on for being a Chad Kogan lookalike. Who knows the fucking lyrics?
He got half them wrong.
Yeah. See, they know the lyrics, dickhead, because they know what I got wrong.
Well, hang on.
Let's see if he doesn't know lyrics. Looketh upon this photograph of this. Every time I do it, makes me smile. What? Were they the right lyrics? You know they weren't, because you sit at home and you're all like, man, I'm made such good money off this song. I was so happy with this song.
I'm going to fucking break something in this studio.
It's probably going to be Red Thunder later on.
Don't you
break.
Pull up that photo, bitch.
I'm not pulling up anything. I'm not going to show you a photograph. I showed it to you last week. Your torture was last week.
I told you.
So, like, I agree. Like, I'm sort of over Felicity.
Yeah.
Like, but
as you should be.
But I really like seeing Stephen, Ollie, in the, what is the name they actually give him? Arsal Hip? Is that the name? The end of the throat?
Yeah, Arsahib, yeah.
Arsahib?
The archer.
That, yeah, it's that the arrow. It's the arrow and
the
end of it.
Yeah, only the arrow remains now, yeah.
Yeah, and the, I like how they, you know how we've had, like, the arrow the whole last three seasons, and it's been that arrow symbol, and they stamped that in his back?
Yeah, that was really cool.
He looks really even more intense with the face mask on, with the black outfit as well, so, I
thought that was just him preparing for Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
No.
Shut up, Braden.
That was a good one, Braden. Don't let these two get you down.
Shut up. Go back to Mo. So, yeah, I thought it looked really intense. Very intimidating. Thea in this was phenomenal. She, what's her name? Willa Holland. Willa Holland. She's constantly improving every episode.
I wanted to see more around that, though. I mean, I know it's going to come, but...
Yeah,
I would have thought that was sort of one of the big focuses of the episode.
Yeah, coming. Yeah, it's a very Jason Todd. It's a very Jason Todd-esque sort of story.
Yeah. Oh, it was good. It was good. I enjoyed it. I still think Flash overtook on TV this week, though.
Oh, it's kind of hard to tell. Like between the two of them. They're doing, like, the last four... if I take it from the last 4 to 5 episodes of each series, I would say Flash has taken off hugely in their writing skill.
Yeah.
But Arrow has remained this constant. So, plus, you can't really compare
the other thing that Flash has, though, Flash has a kind of wealth of actors who have kind of got a very deep experience behind them, barring a couple of the minor characters.
Yeah.
Whereas Arrow is pretty much a fresh cast. Part of the thing is that you... Like, because I swear to you, Tom Cavanagh could read the phone book, and it would be intriguing.
Yeah, absolutely. He could probably read...
You give me 45 minutes of Wells just sitting in the fucking chair. Mm. Literally, I would get angry with it, I'm sure.
Mm.
But I wouldn't be... I would sit there to the screen being like, yeah, I was enjoyed it. I'm just mad.
Mm. I'm just angry he made me feel something.
He moved his foot. Did you see him move his foot again this week?
Yeah. Yeah, I saw it.
Moved his foot. I'm like, bro. And once again, it was the whole dog moving, like, if I move... I know. This actually, that's what I expect from the Reverse Flash, is this kind of slow movement, proving that he is the Reverse Flash.
So when he was falling down over, oh no, not now, he was actually becoming the Reverse Flash.
I actually read a theory on why that was, and it was that he can only go as fast as Barry can go in the Speed Force at that time, because Barry defines the limits of the Speed Force.
Mm-hmm.
And because Harrison was trying to push past those bounds, the Speed Force kicked out on him and just sent him straight to the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And so he didn't. His legs didn't actually stop failing. He just fell over like an idiot.
Are we talking about? Are we talking the one where he's running through Star
Labs? The Piper one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm, all that back then.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I throw that out to you.
That's plausible.
So yeah.
Is that Reddit?
Yeah.
Yeah. Good old Reddit.
Reddit where I am now. Reddit Thunder. That's legit. That is my name on the Reddit time. Reddit Thunder.
Fair enough.
Bloody Thunder.
It was a good episode. That's
the thing. It was one of these weeks on TV where things were good, but just they're bridging towards the ends now. So,
I'm looking for the next, because you were saying, Bray, that there's a crossover for Flash coming where it's everyone against Wells?
Yeah, well, I've seen that in previews. Firestorm was in it. Ollie in his new suit was in it.
Pretty sure Roy's there as well.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah, Ray was there.
No, Roy.
Oh, Roy. I don't know about Roy, but I think Ray was there.
I'm pretty sure I saw the picture.
I know Roy comes back for at least one more episode this season.
Yeah, he's going to have to. Wonder if he'll be sporting a mohawk. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, yeah, alright. Has anybody got anything to say about Arrow this week?
Needs more Diggle.
Yeah. There was a decisive lack of Diggle this week.
It was there, but no Diggle action.
Yeah, but it's not... Diggle, I mean, look, as good as he's standing in the background with his arms crossed, I like it when he's saying things with his arm crossed.
Mm. Man.
He did a good job of turning Masao against the League.
Yeah, but that was, once again, that's what Diggle does. Diggle is the ultimate hero.
Yeah.
He's the talker.
He's the Diggs.
He's the light in darkness.
He's the dark light.
No. Adam knows where I'm going with this.
He is the lantern guiding you home. Mm. In brightest day and blackest night, no evil shall escape his sight. Let's move on to the awards for this week, shall we?
Yeah.
All right, starting off, I'll get into my new award after this. But first off, you gentlemen want to give me your TV awards for the Barbara Gordon bitch or bitch moment of the week.
We'll give Proby a chance for this one.
Mike Cranston.
No.
No, it's Barbara.
Sorry.
Going Barbara.
Fuck me, Proby. If you fuck up too much more again tonight, we're going to punish you properly.
Is it a good punish?
No. We'll come up with something that's fitting, but we will punish you the right way.
You'll have to watch a 3-hour movie.
I know, it'll be beyond that. I'll throw him beyond.
I'm joking, man.
Did you just insult? Because I'll send you with him.
I'm yanking your crank. Calm your tits.
Insulting the mighty Ben Affleck.
Okay, actually, your punishment will be you have to watch Geely.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, no, I'm not a fan of that.
Yeah, there you go.
So, who's your Barbara? For TV, not for the movie.
Barbara for TV. You're going to probably fucking hate me for saying it, bro.
Do already.
I'm going to say Roz.
Sorry, who?
Raish.
Sorry, Raish.
I noticed you didn't jump on Braden's face for saying race. I don't even know how to pronounce it wrong.
Braden pronounces it the American way, and I accept that. Also, the way I figure it is, see, we're in the Batcave. We pronounce things the right way. Braden's in Turagaragamo, which is basically Star City.
Yeah.
So he pronounces it the like way that Ollie does.
Yeah, Raz.
Yeah, Rouse.
Rouse.
Or however it is. Rouse.
So what does Rouse get your award?
Rouse gets my award because he ramped up this whole process of, you know, taking on the mantle as the new Rouse.
It turns out to be an apprenticeship.
Yeah.
Probation.
It's on probation.
Period.
Congratulations. Probation.
But yeah, it was like this ramped up this whole thing about being the new Raish and like he'll have all this wealth of power and fucking knowledge and rah rah rah, and it's just like,
by the way, you just gotta do a 3-month probation course.
You gotta go and do this.
You gotta get your forklift ticket.
I've gotta talk to you about
stuff,
random bullshit for a few weeks.
Fill out this OH&S manual for me, will you?
Please sit through this 20-minute video and fill out this questionnaire.
I can disappear from a helicopter by stepping out of the spotlight, yet I can't make you the race by like
just here, take here, the sword.
Take the mantle here. Like,
and he's got his badge that says like heir to the demon, then below it in training.
In fact, that's what heir to the demon is. It's just on the yellow placard. He's got on his back, and it's just in the background.
Hello, my name is Oliver. I'm new.
Hello, my name is Oliver. If I'm lost, please return to Raish.
Please be patient. It's my first day.
By the way, I'm heir to the demon. Just in case. Proby, he's the senior Proby.
And like, you know,
in Nandapub hat.
And the whole thing with, what's his name?
Maseo.
Like, yeah. That scene, like, yeah, I'm not going to kill you.
Mm. I think the principle behind it, I think for that, was the fact, like, where we always get told a man cannot live by two names. Ray still recognises Maseo is probably still struggling with that.
Yeah.
And it was Maseo who betrayed me, not,
Sarib.
Whatever the fuck it is. Sarab, I think. It's Sarab. I think that's where that comes from. Sarab.
Maseo is dead. I am Sarab.
Sarab.
Because he talks in a very stuttered monotone.
Plus, I would like a kebab. Maybe a falafel. So, yeah, that's fair.
All right, okay. So, let's throw it over to Rara Mo, and let's see who DK has got for his Barbara this week.
I'll go with Olicity. Not just Felicity, Olicity. Actually, no, I'll just go fangirls. You're my fucking Barbaras.
The writers for giving in to fangirls who get your Barbara.
Yeah, exactly. The writers for giving in to fangirls.
Good answer.
We've expressed our hate for this for so long, and they just keep going back to it. Just fucking let it go.
Yeah.
How is it when she actually broke it off with him? She's just like,
can I still borrow your plane?
No, he was just like, take the jet. I think the way I got that, and I'll get into this in a minute, was that Ray was just like, take the jet, fuck a dude if you have to, I guess. That's how much I love you, I'm prepared to let you do that. And she was just like, sweet, thanks, see ya.
See
you when I come back with chlamydia.
I'm pretty sure Ray broke up with Felicity.
Yeah, I think that was. That was actually Ray breaking up with Felicity.
Yeah, because Felicity didn't say it. He goes, you don't love me, you love Ollie.
See you later.
I'm not going to step in front of that. You know,
see you later.
Do what you need to do. Take my plane.
Yep.
And she's like, I'm sorry.
Hey, you're not going to have a job when you get back. Sucked in. Enjoy paying your own bills.
For my life to be over.
Why haven't we got that on the soundboard?
Because you're shit at his job. That's why.
You're a one glover.
Oh, no.
All right, who you got on yours? Badge.
Probably going to drop the C-bomb in this as well. Sal Moroni.
Yeah, that's fair.
Because of the mother?
Yep, you just don't. There's a line that you cross. Every time I see a mob movie, the parents always highly regard, especially the mother. You don't fuck with someone else's mum in that sort of mannerism, you cunt of a man.
And did it in a brutal way, too.
That was a very brutal way. And it's just like, you know what, you know the fact, like, we all know that Penguin's mother's not mentally stable, she's quite fragile, she treasures a relationship with her son in a very Norman Bates way.
So you're saying she's your kind of woman?
No, you fucking twit. Ladies and gentlemen, inbreeding at work. Anyway. So, basically, that was just a bitch move on Sal's part. It was stupid, and he's going to get completely fucked over by Penguin for this.
I can't wait for that.
It's going to be insane. The last still shot I saw of Penguin was of him with, I think it's like a 50 cal machine gun in his hand, wiping dudes out. I'm like, holy shit, when does this happen? I want it now. So, awesome. Sal gets my Barbara.
Yeah. Good answers. Well, see, for me,
I'm glad you approve.
I didn't feel like a barber really summed up how I felt this week. So I've decided a new award is in order for the moments in history that define things. So from now on, ladies and gentlemen, we will have the Felicity Smoke Award for epic moments of hobaggery throughout history. And my first one of these goes to Felicity Smoke. For this week, having an epic moment in hobaggery history where she went in to be all like, hey, Ray, I know we spent the last, like, 3 weeks banging each other and I've been leading you on and, like, getting all the millionaire shit and you probably did up my apartment and, like, bought me a new computer and paid my rent for a year and bought me that car and all that sort of stuff. But, like, can I borrow your plane so I can go off with another guy? I mean, it's nothing sus. And then when he's like, yeah, it's Oliver and you'd love him, don't you? She's just like, yeah, I guess.
See you Monday.
Yeah. And he's like, well, you know, you can still borrow the plane if you want to. And she's just like, okay, cool, I'm going to go have sex with him. And then, like, the body isn't even fucking cold at that point. And she's all like, oh, like, she's still got some array.
Body's not cold yet, or?
She's still got some array's jism just dripping down her leg from earlier this morning. And she's just jumping straight in with Ollie.
She's still got a bit in the back of her throat as well.
Yeah, yeah, it's just disgusting. So that's my problem, is that Felicity went all out on the whole baggery. And just, that is, like... Talk about portraying women as complete pieces of shit.
Mm.
That is like... I had an ex-girlfriend who was like that, and I hated that bitch.
She had the hair down as well for the after-sex hair down.
She's already... Because now she's a woman. She's had that real dick inside her.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah. Yeah, so that's the new award. So from now on, whenever there's a moment in Hobag history, we can hand out the Felicity.
Cool. All right, I'll put that on the board, on the notes.
Yeah, all right. Well, that moves us into the Cranstons for TV for this week. I'm going to start this one off by giving my Cranston Award to Maceo. Maceo not only did the right thing
Maceo
by helping
or
his...
Rob?
Both. Hear me out. Maceo not only did the right thing by helping his friends escape, but he also... Maceo was the one who knelt before Raz and, like a man, was like, if you're going to punish somebody, punish me, I'm responsible.
Mm.
He took his punishment. Like nearly everybody else in this show hides from their punishments,
mm.
He took his punishment like a man. And I respect that. So Maceo gets my Cranston for literally nutting up to the max.
Absolutely. Cool.
So, who's next?
That's a fine argument.
My Cranston goes to Ollie pretty much for the same reason. Like, they're you know, trying to break him out. And, you know, it took too long because they weren't expecting it to. And then, like...
He came to.
He's like, no. This is not how it's happening, guys.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There's one way this happens.
Mm-hmm.
I am the heir to the demon, and you will suck it up.
Yep. The deal has been done. Yep. Absolutely.
And then he went to Raish about it as well, and wasn't just like, you know, I'm going to wait for him to see what happens and wait for the punishment. He went straight to him and said, look,
This is what just happened.
I am here.
Yep.
Please do not kill them, because I am holding up my
end. I'm fulfilling the deal.
Yeah, yep. I'm fulfilling my end of the bargain.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Alright, what do you got badged?
I'm going Ray.
Good call.
Just because I think there isn't a man on the planet that hasn't been in that situation. Where we've had that ex-girlfriend completely share our hearts, but you still go out and do the right thing.
Would have told her to get her own fucking plane, though.
Yeah, I would have just been like, how about you walk, bitch?
But at the same time, like, you still
hit
got...
Hit the bricks. I'll give you some fly, teach you to fly off the roof, cock.
But that's the thing, like, you still, like, we've always had that residual, like, I've had ex-girlfriends ask me for favours, like, well after we've broken up, but it's like a fair favour, but I don't have a plane to give, or a lift into town or something like that, so, you know, you still do it.
She destroyed the foundation that is Farmer. Destroyed it.
I think Ray's going to be better off.
I do too. I think Ray's going to Star City. Not Star City, Central City.
Yeah, he will. He will, but raise my...
He'll be the head of Star Labs now that Harrison Wells is going to be out of there. I mean,
and then Felicity's going to be jobless and living in a...
Well, Felicity will probably rub Parmatech in Star City.
She'll get fired.
Or he'll give the place back to Ollie, or he'll give the company back, and they'll be like, I'm moving on to something else. I'm going to go take care of Star Labs.
He's going to love it.
And then him and Cisco all high-five each other and name shit.
And then Brayden will be like, I hate the relationship.
Yeah, Brayden will be like, it's just too much fun. It's written too well and raised too good a character. I enjoy it too much.
How dare he?
I wish it was shit.
I'm going to
wish everything was shit.
Like Mo.
Yeah, that's your problem. You've been living in Mo too long and it's destroyed you.
I live in fucking Mo.
You just want everything to be shit like your Mo existence.
Mo's like half an hour away.
Not this again.
If you go live in Mo, you fucking must have had your head done in, mate. Your brain must be destroyed from living in Mo.
Mo's pretty much the equivalent to Hackham.
Yeah.
Oi.
And if you don't understand Hackham, let's give that one global meaning for the fans in Italy. It's I'll put it to you this way, in the immortal words of a song. The cold and gray Chicago night, my mother was born to get here. And his mama crashed.
Yeah, but no, Mo's worse than Hackham. So yeah, Bray. Isn't it Bray's Cranston time?
Yeah.
Oh, yes. I'm going Riddleman.
Nice.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure I don't need to explain.
Oh, dear.
Nah, you've said enough. Once you've made the sale, stop selling.
Yep.
No, that's a good answer. That's a good answer.
We all know why. We're all expecting Riddler to do this at some point.
Yeah.
And it happened.
It was great. It was phenomenal as
it
well.
It was amazing.
It was probably the best scene in that
show.
It was. Like with the train tracks and the lights.
I like
the... Oh dear, stab. Oh dear, stab.
But also the fact, to me, because psychopathic killings, particularly for the first one, if you go on to be a killer like that, they do go crazy on the first one because they... Like, you stab somebody once, and you might not necessarily kill them, so they just go into this frenzy overdrive, because you stab somebody 60 times, odds are you're going to kill them. And I think that's what it was. It was just that panic overdrive, but at the same time, because because he liked it, and he's got that psychotic blood taste, it was just like, oh my. I think that's what the idea was. It wasn't just, I've killed a guy, it was, oh dear, I liked that.
I like how he was half... panic, half laugh.
Yeah,
was cool. Whereas it's like almost about to cry, but laughing at the same time. Pure awesomeness.
Break from reality. Yeah,
that was beautiful.
This is a bit of a lore question for you, then, Thunder. Sit in your corner, know your role, shut your mouth. The Riddler doesn't kill all that much, does he? Is that his thing? Because he's always perceived as a bank robber and...
The Riddler likes doing complex shit like that, but I would more think, if you think kind of like Jigsaw in the Saw series, that's the kind of shit Riddler's into, whereby like, he won't kill you just like that.
Set someone up to die.
Yeah. They're trapped. Like, the Batman Forever one is pretty close to Riddler, where it's like, there's two traps, two people you want to save, I'm going to drop them both.
Yep.
Make a choice.
Yep.
Look in the Arkham games, how many people he'd set up in traps and you got to get them out.
Yeah.
Otherwise they die.
Yep.
It's that's what he is. So yeah, he's not one to get his hands dirty. Yeah.
Yeah.
He likes to watch from afar and kind of ridicule you for sucking.
Yeah.
That's why he hates Batman. That's what this thing will be about, will be this villain of the Riddler will end up bored.
Yeah.
Because he's so much smarter than everybody else, who out with the cops, so that he needs Batman to turn up so he can actually have a challenge.
Yep.
So yeah, that's cool. The lore.
There you go. Sweet.
That's the law and order, you might say.
In the criminal justice system, the people are represented by two separate yet equally important groups, the police who investigate crime and the district attorneys who prosecute the offenders. These are their stories.
Fair enough.
Well, then that brings us to this week's feature film.
And now for our feature presentation.
David Banner wanted to end the running. He wanted to live in peace.
You have to stop someplace.
But once again, they made him angry. Maybe angry enough to kill.
Maybe I belong in a cage.
Now, imprisoned, he will struggle to hide the fury within him. But he will not succeed.
I can't stand trial.
You have no choice.
Because now David Banner faces his greatest trial. The trial of the Incredible Hulk.
That's right, this week it's the trial of the Incredible Hulk. Which gives us a plot which goes something like this. On the run again after the events of the previous TV movie, David Banner is now working up north under the name David Belson. Disenchanted and at the end of his rope, David makes his way towards a large city with the hopes of renting a room and staying buried. Unbeknownst to him, the city he arrives in is under the control of a powerful underworld kingpin named Wilson Fisk, but is also protected by a mysterious black clad crime fighter known as Daredevil. When two of Fisk's men come onto a computer subway train after having committed a jewelry robbery, one of them takes an interest in a beautiful woman also riding the train, and she rejects him. David witnesses an attempted sexual assault by one of Fisk's men. He transforms into the Hulk and things go haywire. A short while later, David is arrested by the police and wrongfully charged with the crime. While awaiting trial, blind defense attorney Matt Murdock is assigned to David's case. David is uncooperative, but Murdock has faith in him and that faith that he's innocent, and is determined to prove that so to the world. One night while fast asleep, David has a nightmare about his upcoming trial and dreams about transforming into the Hulk on the witness stand. The stress of this causes him to transform in reality, and the Hulk subsequently breaks free of prison. The next events see David Banner team up with Daredevil, who reveals his identity as Matt Murdock. Matt tells David about his origins, which David has trouble accepting at first. Daredevil also reveals he has an ally on the police force who provides him with information relating to criminal activity. As Daredevil, Matt goes to investigate a tip provided by his informant. The tip turns out to have been planted by the Kingpin, and Daredevil is badly hurt in an ambush by Kingpin's men. David rushes to save Matt, but he is too late to help, becomes angry, and transforms into the Hulk. The Hulk in turn smashes in and saves Matt, and Kingpin and his men flee. Matt, who is barely conscious, traces the Hulk's face as he transforms back to David, thus learning his secret. In the meantime, Kingpin has witnessed to the events on the subway, abducted from protective custody in order to have her killed, but she is saved at the last moment by the Kingpin's assistant, who finds her attractive. The Kingpin is also planning a major meeting of underworld crime lords in order to propose a consolidation of their operations into a big syndicate with himself as the chairman. David, who is trained as a medical doctor, treats Matt's injuries and spreads the cover story that Matt got hurt falling down the stairs. Matt's self-confidence is shaken. David's confidence, on the other hand, has been restored by seeing how Matt has embraced his unique gifts, also caused by exposure to radiation. After a little coaxing from David, Matt begins to recover and retrain his body. Soon enough, the two return to work and go to save the captured woman. The two engage the Kingpin and his men and ultimately succeed in beating him. Kingpin and his assistant escape, and the prisoner is freed. The two part ways as friends and allies, with David planning ahead in search of a cure for himself, and Matt will stay in his city and protect it as the Daredevil. Gentlemen, what did you think?
And chapter two.
Not great.
Yeah, it wasn't as good as the first one.
No.
It's sort of sad to see something like this happen to a decent
show,
franchise.
Yeah, good word. Yeah.
I've been reading Thesaurus lately. I want to increase my vocabulary from $5 to $10.
Good luck with that.
Yeah, it's
good. I think you'll find you need more cigars and scotch to increase your skills. That's what I did. I just sat in a room filled with oak.
And oak and
scotch and smoked cigars and drank scotch and let it absorb into me like osmosis.
But yeah, it's really disheartening to see. Even the filming quality of it is shocking.
Yep.
It was nice to see, who played the Kingpin? We discussed this earlier. Who was that?
John Rhys-Davies.
Who
is known from Indiana Jones and Lord of the Rings.
And Sliders.
Yeah,
well.
Of course, Sliders, yeah.
That's where I automatically get him from.
I think of Gimli. My ox! Whenever I saw him, I was just like, have my ox!
That's right. He played him, I keep forgetting. But, you know, I always liked seeing him, but this depiction of the Kingpin...
It's crap.
I was confused.
Yeah, crap. I was confused too, yeah.
So confused.
Like, did he want to make love with that TV?
He's some... I get the whole you want to stay anonymous and all that sort of stuff, but because when it came down to it, went back to the web, like the old TV studio where, you know, it was shut down and all that sort of stuff. Yeah. That's where the trap was. It was part of me thinking, well, is this Kingpin they're trying to depict, the former owner of this studio, and he sort of kept it and he has a thing for film and television? Or, yeah, but other than that, it's good to see Stan Lee. This was his first, like, one of his first movie appearances in the jury. Yep. With a bit more pepper in the head.
In the jury.
Yeah, he was in the...
This was indeed, you've hit the nail on the head, the first ever Stan Lee cameo.
Yeah, I saw it and like me and Matt were like, is that Stan Lee? I'm like, yep, that's Stan Lee. And so it's sort of like that sort of started. And it was... There's part of me that wants to love this film a lot, but there's... The majority of me is just I can't.
Yeah.
It's kind of like, you know, you just can't.
No,
you just
I know
can't.
How it feels.
Mm. So that's pretty much...
Was Luke Ferrigno a huge amount huger in this one?
I think this was at one of his peaks of either roiding up or when he's... Because what year was this movie?
Been roiding.
I think this was 84. Let me double check.
If it's 84, that means Ferrigno and Schwarzenegger were still competing. I think Pumping Iron came out about 86. So Ferrigno was actually constantly coming second to Schwarzenegger.
Oh, this was 89.
Right,
so
really.
This would have been... This may have even been at the stage where they swapped over from steroids, because it's the aftermath of just before the wrestling steroid trial.
Yeah.
In fact, it would be the height of steroids.
Yeah, this would be
before the steroid trials.
So, this is also when he's competing against Schwarzenegger. So,
yep.
When he's he is flexing a lot more, like we notice, like you can see like the muscles along his ribs a lot more. His shoulders were more, they were just massive.
Yeah.
So this was probably nearing his peak of
I think he's actually bigger in the next one.
Really?
Wow. I think the next one is that he's at his biggest ever.
Far out. That's in a phenomenal
one.
We do not condone the taking of drugs.
Drugs are bad, okay?
Okay.
Sure.
Bray, what do you think?
Yeah, I was a little bit bored.
Yep.
I only watched this movie probably about, for the first time, I've never seen it before tonight. I only probably watched it about 2 hours ago, 2-3 hours ago. I struggled to keep focus on it, partly because I was a little bit bored, and partly because my kids were being little shit.
probably because they were bored too.
Yeah, probably.
Probably because you suffered them to jail.
Frontier.
They're actually
still suffering the brain age.
Now, what's happening still. Is the cerebellum is actually forming back into a brain instead of being a pile of mush. So that's what's happening. They're discovering math again.
There you go. Code cracked.
Yeah.
I liked Daredevil's costume, though.
You did?
I did like it.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I didn't like that.
Are you serious?
Okay, I haven't watched the Netflix series yet.
Okay, I'm going to put this to you this way, Braden.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say that my Achilles heel, I have a really bad right knee. I'm not going to walk into a fight with a bullseye painted on my right fucking knee, like Matt Murdock walking in with his cap, with his obvious I'm blind with the shit covering my eyes because I can't see bollocks. Like, way to point out that you're blind. Like, is he blind? Well, yeah, I would say he is, considering he doesn't need to fucking see.
I would like to mention one thing. In the trap, they actually try to dazzle him with like lights and things like that. Doesn't work.
Yeah, yeah.
And no one has taken him on has realized he's got no eye holes. He can't see me.
But then immediately they do the sound, and he's like, ah, vision doesn't do anything.
Mm-mm.
Noise does, and it's like, well, five minutes looking at this dude would join the dots.
Mm.
So that's it's.
Mm.
You're wrong. That's what I'm saying to you, Braden.
I get the.
I don't know how those things work there in Moe for costumes, but that was wrong.
Moccasins.
Mm. Moccasins. Yeah, that's your problem. Moccasin. He didn't have a mullet. He didn't have a fully sweet mullet and a bum bag.
Missing a couple of front teeth. Yeah.
Wasn't all methed up.
Is your car on cinder blocks?
haven't you listened to our treasure? Braden lives in Moe. He's poor. He doesn't drive.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
He doesn't own a car.
Hmm.
He's in the ghetto. It's cold and grey Chicago night.
I don't live in fucking Maui.
Ghetto.
Dragon's just as bad.
Find the gun. Kill someone. But it won't be run. In the ghetto.
In the ghetto.
How do I keep hanging out? Every time you sing that, I just my head instantly goes back to Firefly's intro song.
Mm.
Take my land, take. You can't take your freedom away.
You can't
from
take
me.
The sky from me. Yeah. Now I have found serenity.
Actually, when you just sung that song, that reminded me of a video I've seen on YouTube.
Just not slow by the Reverse Flash. Yeah, I've seen that one too.
It was sung by the cast of the Flash. Actually, it was
You mean like
Cisco,
one of them was on Glee?
And Joe, all singing that song. They were singing it to Joss Whedon because he donated money to them to them at their writing.
Oh, their movie thing, yeah.
God, the Kickstarter, yeah.
Yeah.
All
right. Yeah.
Well, there you go. I guess you can't take the sky from them.
Mm. Yeah.
Bastards.
I hope Firefly comes back.
Yeah. It never will.
Yeah. Shut up. One can hope.
Well, man, you need to stop waiting because for that your life is over. I'll tell you right now, what will it be? It will be no. Sorry. Firefly ain't coming back.
The soundboard isn't working.
So this... There was one thing in this film, though, and I don't know why. Ever since I can remember seeing this film when I was maybe 8, first time I remember seeing it.
Mm-hmm.
It's bugged me since then. Every year since then.
Mm-hmm.
And I know it's just a dream, but it really fucking irritates me. David Banner has a beard. The Hulk doesn't.
Yeah.
And he get every time I'm like, why does the beard disappear? Why? That makes no sense. And I'm looking at it, I'm like, you've already put a wig on his head. I know that's not Lou Ferrigno's hair. How hard would it be to slap a beard on too?
A really cheesy Abe Lincoln style beard.
Like, how hard would it be? I wouldn't care if the moustache disappeared. Just seriously.
For the
like,
Hulk though, consider everything gets tougher, he, like, just put steel wool on his cheeks.
But yeah, just, it really got to me was that the Hulk did not have a beard.
Mm.
Yeah. I noticed that.
I will mention one thing, though. I mean, I shit on Edward Norton because I don't like him that much. All that much. Now, I watched The Incredible Hulk.
But he's no Ben Affleck.
He's no Ben Affleck. Captain Shortcomings over there is having a problem.
No, dickhead over here gave me the thing.
Sorry, Chad Shortcomings Proby, did you say?
Yeah. Matt, don't call me Proby. Chad Proby, Shortcomings Proby, Richens Proby.
Matt, you can do Brad as Shortcomings Proby.
Yeah. That's what his wife calls him. Anyway, I noticed that Edward Norton's performance as Bruce Banner was actually quite similar in comparison to Bill Bixby's Bruce Banner. It's actually very mild-mannered. That's why I actually kind of like
it. I think Mark Ruffalo's is very close to that as well.
Yeah, that's one thing I like about Bill Bixby is he actually plays the scientist with the problem very well. He doesn't harp on it.
Bill Bixby just is so overclassed compared to everybody else in this film, though. Absolutely. And it's almost a problem.
It is. It's a massive issue for me was Matt Murdock. Yep. That was just an issue for me. I don't know why. I don't like the idea of, you know, I've seen the Netflix series, so I sort of, I don't know how lore this could be. But him, like, in the Netflix series, his dad has that fight and bets on himself and wins and all that money and sets a trust fund for him.
Yep.
Now, I don't know if that is lore.
Close enough.
So I don't like, I don't know, if after 10 years he's living in this big mansion and all that sort of stuff. If he's doing free work.
No, he's doing, court-appointed.
Yeah, court-appointed free legal. I don't get that. Yeah. It doesn't sit right with me. The actors seem just not to be into it.
It's no Eric Allen Kramer.
No.
What I don't get is the fact that this can't be the first time that he's been beaten down. Yeah, this one is just like crushed his spirit.
Because they normally just use lights. This time they use sound.
But surely he's been beaten to within an inch of his life before.
Not with sound.
Oh, sorry.
You ever had your ass kicked to a soundtrack? That shit is embarrassing.
Yeah, I got for fucking Nickelback, bitch.
I got my ass whooped last week to Dark Horse. That was horrible. It's a Nickelback album. I did some research before coming on the show.
I refuse to believe that.
No, my brother's actually a fan of Nickelback. It's our family shame.
Suck it.
He doesn't look like it.
It's easy for you to talk. You make the music.
You retard. You and your royalties and your long hair. You're not quite finished facial hair. I know how you are.
I know you never made it as a blind man and you couldn't cut it as a poor man stealing.
But Chad Kroeger never made it as a fucking rock star either. Fucking dickhead.
Man, you just need to get over it and just be like, why don't you and Chad Kroeger together fly onto heaven and...
Fuck you, Thunder! You can suck my dick! You can't get me, Thunder, because you're just God's fart!
Straight onto heaven, because without him, they're never going to let you in. Anyway,
we digress.
Later on, I'll tell you what, at the end of this episode, we're going to get into what your punishment's going to be for the mistakes you've made here in the last few weeks. But when you get back from that, we're going to put a soundtrack on, I'm going to kick your ass to it, and then you can see what it's like to get your ass kicked to a soundtrack.
It's not even going to be music.
Yeah.
It's going to be what they used to test.
It's going to be the Dawson's Creek theme where I beat the piss out of him. And he's all like, and I'll be like, remember this. When you're next time you're waiting in a queue and you're like, man, or next time you get depressed, you're like, I wish my life was over. You remember this beating? Because you don't want this. You don't want to wait for another beating like this. Punch.
Good on you.
Judo shop.
Yeah. Cool.
So open up your morning light and watch as I put my fist through your eye.
Anyway.
So anyway, let's talk about this film some more. I know it was bad, so that means we should be able to shit on it. Mm. I did like Hulk ripping up a courtroom. I thought that was great. I also like Hulk busting out of a jail cell and everybody being like, what the hell was that?
Yeah, that courtroom scene, I just had JR from the old WWE just in my head. Every time someone got put through a table...
That's it, he's dead.
Yeah, that's it, he's dead. Stop the damn match!
Ah, son of a bitch!
Basically, and I do like how he actually ripped up the juror's box and there was cobwebs and stuff underneath. I'm like, that's actually really good planning ahead because they actually raised a little bit. You can imagine that. So that's a little... I think that's where the budget went.
You didn't go into Lou Ferrigno's wig, that's for sure.
It never goes into the wig.
All the sound effects. No. Guess what? That really, really bugged me, this movie.
Yeah?
They obviously added in sound effects and stuff for the movie better than last one, but...
Ah, my nipples, they hurt! They hurt when I twist them!
The fucking pieces of shit added in a sound for every time he stepped the first time, but not every subsequent step after that. So he steps off the train, and you hear a thud, and then he runs down the train station like a fucking a leaf in the wind.
Can I ask you something? Did he have his light on at the time? Because if not, then clearly he's... clearly he's cloaked.
No, there was lights in the subway station.
No, did he have his light on?
No.
Because there can be light around you. You just need your personal light on, or else you're cloaked. Do you know nothing about cloaking audio technology?
But in saying
mutton
that,
chop.
Okay, so when he hides into the fucking shadows and you can hear him breathing, when he's in the shadow with no light, you piece of shit. But when he's running in the middle of the lights down a fucking street or down a subway station, you can only hear the first step.
Yeah, because the cloak covers external noises, not internal noises, and breathing's an internal
noise.
It's kind
of like the Invisible Warden, woman.
You don't know anything about cloaking, do you? You fucking clown shoe. Brad, what do you think was good about this film?
I thought that just froze then.
No, he doesn't have anything to say.
No, he's literally still for a second, like, shit.
Yeah, stumped him with that mind-breaker of a question.
Yeah, pretty much. There was more comical things in it, like, just some of the things said and done, the flexing Lou Ferrigno, which I know happened a lot in the first, but it was just so much more prominent in this one. But in the courtroom, he spent more time flexing than he did actually smashing shit. I really like, I was thinking about it before when I was going to say it, but I forgot what it was now. That's right, when he got done by the sound, when Daredevil got done by the sound, and Bruce is, giving him his pep talk. It's like, that sound would have hurt anybody, blah, 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 whatever. Except for the guys who were kicking his ass.
Yeah.
They actually all had earphones on.
Did they?
Yeah, they did. Yeah, no, I actually, I paid attention to that point, because at that point in time, what I found interesting, though, is the woman, the really attractive woman with the massive, massive hair,
yeah.
She was just sitting there just exposed to it.
Her head got bigger as the movie went on.
Fuck! But the other dudes, everyone else, headphones.
She did scream, what is happening?
Yeah, that's true. So, the henchmen did have...
She was blinded by the light.
No, that's
wrapped
true.
Up like a deuce, another rumor in the net, blended badly. She got down, but she never gonna take her, gonna make her through the net. She gonna make it. Through the net.
Anyway.
So yeah, it was just no.
Blended bad.
Now all the henchmen did have headphones. Kingpin had headphones. I want to know what was up with his sunglasses, but I'll let you finish, Brayden.
I don't really have
I had a theory on that. Right, that they didn't explore it in this film, because originally this was much like the last one, where they were trying to make a pilot for Daredevil and be like, yeah, Daredevil's going to be the next show that's going to be awesome, and tune in on Fox. And then it didn't happen, but I think their plan originally was to be like, well, what if Daredevil's blind, but his villain's blind too? Oh, snap, two blind guys for the price of one this Thursday on Fox!
Everyone, I'd like to direct your attention to the car park. Cripple fight in the car park. I repeat, cripple fight in the car park.
So that's my theory, was that he wore the sunglasses for that.
Yeah.
Either that or he's trying to be Bono.
Bono?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going with Bono.
Yeah, that's fine theory.
I don't like your Daredevil in my turn.
In the name of love, they just hooked up in the name of love.
What about the starving children, though? Matt, what about the starving children? Oh, I'm just testing it for the starving children.
Yeah.
I hate Bono.
That was Father Ted.
I can't stand that, the fact that the big crime lord for this town is like...
wearing a mullet?
Fucking pansiest piece of shit you could think of. Like, he says a couple of words and is like...
Oh, and the worst part is that John Rhys-Davies is like 6'4".
He's huge.
Like, he's a massive, intimidating guy that you would think would be...
I agree with you for once. Right? It's just...
He agrees with you by choice, is what he's saying.
Well said.
We'll have that one moment.
Fuck it, done.
No, you're agreeing by choice.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, like, I think what Probe was trying to get to is, like, they have this phenomenal actor who can give that sort of screen presence.
And they waste him.
That's wasted. We're going to have you sit in a chair.
Yeah. The other thing that made me really sad as well is that you have Bill Bixby and John Rhys-Davies, and you don't have them interact.
Bad move. Bad juju.
Oh, man. Like, come on. It's still a Hulk movie, and the Hulk's... But, like, I think that what went wrong here is the last one, it's a Hulk movie, and Thor's the guest star.
Mm-hmm.
This one felt more like it's a Daredevil film, and the Hulk's just here to, like, be like, I don't want to get angry. But I just want to be cured.
Yep, bang on.
If I could be cured, it'd be great. I'd go home. Got a reporter chase me. He's not here now. I've lost him for now. But he'll chase me eventually. But
I'll be the next one.
I want to be cured. Don't want any trouble.
Yeah, absolutely.
Not interested in jail. Don't make me angry. I'm not. Yep. If we could all just shake hands, would be a better place.
You made me angry.
Yeah, and then it's like, oh, dun 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 dun.
What old
dun 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 dun. Da, na, na. That song is like burned into my head, man. I know that.
I don't know why. At a point where Banner was like, "No, your eyes can't be healed," it almost felt like there was a point where Daredevil was going to say, "Well, I wouldn't want my eyes to be healed because of what I can do now."
Yeah. It is.
But then when the Hulk said, "If I could be cured of this shit, I would want to be cured of this shit," even though they sort of pep-talked each other throughout the whole movie to, like, embrace their shit. And then Daredevil turns, or Matt Murdock turns to him and goes, "You poor soul." And then, Bill Bixby...
But I think that was just more because, like, I mean, think about it. If right now in this room, one of us hulked out and then de-hulked down, you probably would be like, "You poor..."
Well, there wouldn't be a studio. It'd be fucking paste.
Well, if you made him, it depends. If it's just like Hulk, who's just kind of like mildly annoyed,
bust through your door.
Mildly annoyed Hulk, he might not be so bad.
I would love to see that as a sitcom.
Mildly annoyed Hulk.
Yeah, the slightly impressive Hulk, the overachiever Hulk,
punching out of his league Hulk,
bust through that glass ceiling.
Exactly.
Oh god.
All right. Well, are there any last thoughts before we get to the awards section?
This needed a bigger budget.
Yeah.
That's all I can say. This is just
need better acting.
Just Bill Bixby. Give me Bill Bixby.
If this would have had Ben Affleck as Daredevil, it would have made a better film.
Yep. Yeah. No, I agree.
So, all right. Well, let's get into the awards for this film. Let's start off with the Barbara Gordon bitch out personal moment of the film.
Matt Murdock. Just his little sook fest.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm gonna say that Proby late jumped onto my idea there, because Matt Murdock is the correct answer. He was a complete bitch fest in this.
Yeah. No, I agree.
Yeah, I want to be a hero, and now I got punched once, and I don't want to do it anymore.
I agree. I'm gonna late jump on that one as well.
My side hurts.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Not like this. Not today. Later! I said later!
Why did he turn into the little German kid from The Simpsons there? Please don't make me fight, Mr. Hulk! I'm full of chocolates!
Or Hans from, what is it, bloody Willy Wonka and Chocolate Factory.
I don't get it. Just...
No, I'm going to late jump on that one.
Yep. Alright, so you got Bray?
I'm struggling with this one, but I'm not going to late jump. I think I'll I might go with the big head woman.
Hat description. And are you just giving it to her for her hair alone or with the other qualities?
That's a large contributing factor.
80% of the award goes to the hair.
Yeah, she was a bitch fest herself. She just... la-la.
Yeah.
Yep. And the point where she was lying on the bed and the dude was like, go on, smother her. And the dude's like 2-3 feet away from me and she doesn't even fucking move.
Yeah,
like, if someone's gonna fucking smother me,
throws the pillow at the other guy.
Yeah.
Take that!
But you know, if someone's gonna fucking smother you and you're not handcuffed to anything, as if you wouldn't just be like, you know what, fuck this, I'm fighting for it.
Yep.
Yeah, true.
Kick you in the throat.
That's true.
It's a pair of barbers.
Okay, so that's the barbers. Now let's head to our Cranstons. Who are you giving them to?
Bill Bixby.
Actually, yeah, Bill Bixby. I was going to say Incredible Hulk, but if he'd had the beard, he would have got it. But Bill Bixby.
I mean, that's the thing. He's phenomenal.
Yeah.
Guys, I actually want to go out and look for more of his films. So.
Yeah, I'm trying to find something else in that movie to.
Besides Bill, there is nothing. You get a free pass on like jumping on this.
Bill
one.
Bixby.
And what do you got, Fred?
I'm going to give it to the
big head woman.
I'm going to give it to the big head woman.
Sorry,
I'm gonna give it to the outro music. I just love that music.
The Lonely Man.
What the fuck was with that flying contraption at the end?
At the end, yeah. I don't know what that was.
Dinghy with the jet.
A dinghy. Yeah, let's
rub it up.
I felt like Daredevil could have caught that.
Just before it took off, where he only saw a portion of it, I swear it looked like the speedster from Star Wars.
That's what I thought it was as well. Yes. That's exactly what I was going to say. Looks like the
fucking speedster.
Yeah.
The fucking late jumping on the fucking Star Wars.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a Zodiac. It's a rubber Zodiac that the lifeguards use.
Yeah.
With, like, I think it was with a Japanese Supra spoiler on the back with a jet engine in there somewhere. Yeah. And somehow that created lift.
Yeah.
You look at that thing, it's like...
There's no wings on it.
There's no wings. There's no way to create lift.
It's a spoiler.
Yeah. Great downforce, not updraft.
It was fucking shit.
It was horrible.
And it made no sense in the rest of the movie. Like,
no, it didn't. I'm just waiting. There's part of me that wishes they had like a blimp. Like a <Yeah. sandwich>. And then like there's, and then Bruce, like David Banner's on there going, no tickets, out the window.
See, I'd rather they had like the step before that with like the bicycle with the flappy wing.
Well, at least a
Kingpin's bike.
Kingpin's, yeah, just sitting in the front like E.T. and like the assistant peddling like Smithers.
Or like a remake of like the Wright Brothers' first airplane.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just puts on the ego suit and just jumps off the fucking roof.
Oh, it's ridiculous. It was horrible. It's one of those movies you kind of have to watch to understand how bad it is, but Bill Bixby's fantastic in it.
Yeah.
So it's just how that is.
But I can't really honestly say, go and watch this movie just because Bill Bixby is in it, because...
I actually like...
As awesome as Bill Bixby is, like, I can't...
If you want to watch something for Bill Bixby, watch Return of the Incredible Hulk.
Return, or even the TV series.
Because he's still good in it. Yeah, the TV series is all Bill Bixby all
That's
the time.
It is, with
100%
two Hulk
Bill
outs.
Bixby.
Well, there you go.
So go watch the TV show.
So, yeah, so two Hulk outs, 45-minute show. It's about 5 minutes each. So you're looking at a solid 35 minutes of Bill Bixby.
Yeah, 32 minutes, not including ads.
No, that's weird because it's a 1970s show, so I've taken out the outbreak already. It's 45 minutes.
It is a... Wow.
In fact, I think they might be 50 minutes long.
That's quality.
Because Starsky and Hutch runs 52 minutes.
No shit.
Which shows us, yeah, they've got...
Ads back in the day were like 2-3 ads at best.
Yeah, they've literally doubled the amount of ad
Hold
time.
Hold on, let's just take a moment of silence just to remember those days. Just...
And the ads over. And the ads are now over and we're back into the show.
Yeah.
So yeah, well that brings us to the last segment, the Bat Sack. And has any gentleman, have you got anything from the Bat Sack?
No, I've got nothing. Yeah.
Got nothing? I have something, so hit the theme music. Alright, the following one comes from our dear old friend, Pseudonym. And she writes in to say this. Dear from the Batcave, have you gentlemen seen the Avengers films? Or the Mighty Ducks films before? Oh yes, Sue, I've seen both. Why do you ask? And she goes on to say, the reason I ask this is, have you noticed they both share pretty much the same theme song?
The same?
The same then, though. I'm Arsenal. So, I've got a little bit of an audio sample here of each. We're going to test this out. We're going to see. So, first of all, here comes the theme from the Mighty Ducks.
Okay. Go here.
Okay, so that was Mighty Ducks.
That's now, an epic intro.
Now let's have a look at some of...
wanted to bleed into Superman then.
I actually more felt Captain America than I did Superman. Alright, here we go. Now let's have a look at the Avengers. Give it a sec to build up. Get better. Now take out the remix.
That is like.
I think Sue's hit the nail on the head.
She's broken.
Yeah, I think the code. The difference. See, I was listening to that in my headphones, and there's definitely a difference where the Avengers music they used a triangle.
Ah, those clever bastards.
There's Hulk in the corner with the triangle. Ding! Damn it!
Are they written by the same...
No. The Avengers theme, I believe, is... I want to say Danny Elfman... Oh, I know Danny Elfman at least performed it for the new Avengers, but originally it was written by a guy named Alan Silverstead.
Right.
And the Mighty Ducks theme is by David Newman. So two very different guys.
That's crazy. Disney's not going to be happening.
Well, Disney does own it. Own them both now. Marvel is a Disney.
Oh,
so there could be that. But yeah, so...
It'll be the next thing of, like, you know, when people say, you know, try and sing Star Wars theme, then Superman theme. This will be the next one. You know, sing the Mighty Ducks theme, then sing Avengers theme.
Well, yeah, so there you go. Little interesting fact here from the Batcave that the Avengers are, in fact, just the Mighty Ducks grown up.
Nice.
Nice.
And, pulling it all together in a nice from the Batcave way, we of course know who... the head of the Mighty Ducks was, it was the man himself, Pacey from the Creek. And in honor of Pacey, I give you this.
So open up your morning light, say a little prayer for I. You know that if we are to stay alive, and see the peace in every eye.
That was, of course, the Gotham.
Every time.
Well, unless anybody else has anything they'd like to say, I think that about wraps it up for this week.
No. Got nothing.
Pretty much.
Yep, good.
Well, on that exciting, upbeat, shenanigan-like ending, it's time to say goodnight on behalf of myself, Red Thunder Adam Gerard, and my cohorts, conspirators, compadres, and compatriots in crime, the Honey Vegetarian Neil.
Got
the Dad Knight, Bredner Hearn.
Farewell.
And Preview Mick Fuck Up himself,
Mr. Shortcomings,
Matt Richards, which brings me to a very important point. You nearly got away scot-free.
Fuck off.
But before we leave, we need to open up the Tribunal Commission, because Matthew Richards, you've failed your job quite a few times, and we thought about this long and hard. The Brain Trust got together.
Is this another one of those things where, like, you're going to say that I'm out, but I'm not, and you're going to actually promote me?
No. We were going to send you to Siberia. But we decided Siberia is too nice this time of year. So instead, the ultimate punishment we are giving you is a four-week, all-expenses-paid vacation.
All right.
To Leanne Yu.
Oh, fuck.
With the gimp.
Not the gimp.
The gimp.
Come on.
And in that time, Proby, I expect that you will learn how to operate your soundboard properly, how to recap a show properly, and if not, we will send you back down that hole. And if you once again get a lawyer coming knocking on the door of the From the Batcave Studios, delivering papers against you because Chad Kroeger is suing you for looking like him because you refuse to get the cosmetic surgery that he demands, then Proby, we are going to have a serious problem here. Do you have anything to say for yourself?
Fuck you, Thunder! You can suck my dick! You can't get me, Thunder!
Pretty much, because... fast. You know what? I'm not fucking changing my appearance for anyone. So, Chad Kroeger can go fuck himself, because he looked like me, rather than me looking like him.
Who's
Second
older?
Of all, how the fuck can I improve my service on the... fucking tablet. Oh, sorry,
by pressing the right buttons?
Okay, so how can I get everything set up properly how you want me to when you're fucking going to suspend me over into Lian Yu for 4 fucking weeks with no internet and no fucking access to anything?
They have dial-up. They've got 52K.
I don't have a fucking dial-up modem.
They do. They have it all there.
You with Wi-Fi? Yeah, good on you, dickhead.
I think I've just extended the 5 weeks.
If you were really as good an electrician as you say you are, you'd be able to MacGyver this problem.
Oh, I'm
instead of sitting here bitching to me. Because let me tell you something about the members of the Just Us League. Brayden, if I gave you a paperclip and a chewing gum wrapper, could you make a modem?
I would make a modem.
Okay.
A Wi-Fi modem.
Exactly. Badge, let me ask you, if I gave you a condom and 2 paddle pop sticks, could you make a boat?
Yeah, absolutely.
Here's the thing.
A modem.
I once made a helicopter out of a glue stick. And it was empty. It was an empty glue stick and I made a helicopter. So you're going to sit there and tell me you can't find fucking Wi-Fi or some shit, you can't hack a signal. This is what I'm talking about, Proby. You don't have any sort of care or like, just, there's no commitment to your job. Do you even want to be one of the Just Us League members? Or do you want to be one of them, who is we evil villain members?
I don't care what I say because it's not going to matter, is it?
Get the handcuffs, he's going to Leanne Yu. We'll see you next week from the Batcave when we'll let Proby check in live from Leanne Yu and tell us what the tin coffee making facilities are like. Until then, on behalf of everybody here from the Batcave, thank you so much for joining us. Don't forget to hit us up on Facebook or on WordPress and let us know what you think. Email through any questions you have. You can always submit them there or email us as well. Email address and everything is on our Facebook page. Thank you very much for listening, and until next week, on behalf of myself and all the team here, well, not all the team here, obviously Proby's going to be in Land U, we'll see you next week.
Who are you?
There's no lube at that, like, don't drop the soap, there's no lube, and there's some big burly prisoners there.
The Gimp doesn't wash as well, by the way.
The Gimp hasn't washed since he put that suit on.
It's alright, I think Leon used a step up from Hackman.
Better than Mo.
Better than Mo.
Well, true, I'll go rag and rag, Mo.
Or better than Melbourne in general.
I'm hungry. I'm Batman.
Why does it always end up like every single episode? Like I'm...
Because you suck. They didn't finish the thought. Because you suck.
That's what we brought you.
Fucking rag on me. Like, the last hour, like, you're just like, yeah, we'll just ease it in, and then last...
That sounds like my sex life, the last hour, just ease it in and ride it on out from there.
Yeah, pretty much.
Like I said, like, the first time you hear it's just a tip, just a little bit, just to see how it feels. But the rest is the rest of the 12
inches. Yeah, now we're at the point where, you know that big, you know those big things that look like a vase that chicks sit on? One of those.
Jesus, man.
The internal organ plug.
This has been a Cabana production.
Proby's gonna get butt destroyed.
World! Fuck off!